Go ahead and put that slide up there, the Happy New Year one. Go ahead and roll it on up there. I'm not going to ask you to Exodus. There you go. I'm not going to ask you to go to Exodus tonight, okay? And we may be a couple of nights out of Exodus, but I wanted to kind of work a little bit on what we worked on Sunday night. Does anybody need a copy of the handout? Did they get a copy of the handout? Everybody got a copy? Bill, you come. Do you got one? I'm going to say. You didn't get one, Miss Maria? Oh, Miss Maria, do you want one too? Here you go. Yeah, that was what I was talking about, the copy of the handout. This one right here on values and stuff. Thank you, ma'am. So, I titled this little foray into the unknown, Happy New Year. Because I told you Sunday night that we were starting a new year. And we are starting a new year. In September, we will begin again with a new year. And so we began to talk about some things as it relates to the church and as it relates to vision. Okay? And so what you have in front of you is kind of a culmination of what we've talked about. If I turn this on, it will help tremendously. Right. So, I asked you a question. I said, what do you value about Bethesda? And we use Proverbs 29 and 18. It says, where there is no vision, the people perish. Okay? And according to Webster's, value is a person's principles or standards of behavior, one's judgment of what is important in life. Now, on your paper, you have two columns. Everybody see that? One's intentional, and the other one is what? Actual. Now, I move these around, okay? And I want you to think about them for just a minute, because you remember what we said? Sometimes we have some good intentions, but we don't never put no action to them, okay? One of those what might be, hey, you know what? We'd like to see some younger folks get here. Well, what's the problem with that? Younger folks are going to do what? Bring munchkins with them. Munchkins do what? Especially ones that have never been in church. Are going to destroy everything they can get their hands on. Is that not right? And most of the time, mama and daddy ain't going to tell them because they ain't never been in church. Don't do that. So what happens is we get short with the munchkins. Guess what mom and dad do? See ya. Right? So we say we really want younger people here, but we really don't want to sacrifice nothing for younger people to be here. Is that a true statement? That's the difference between actual and intentional. You hear people say, well, I value the fact that our church prays, okay? Do we need to pray more or less? Okay, we need to pray more, right? Okay, what are we doing to pray more? How many people are here now, Ernie? You got any idea in here? 40, 50. It's usually 40, 50, okay? All right. Y'all don't know what they call this service, do you? Prayer meeting. Is that not right? Why don't we have 150 people in here if we need to be praying more? Because maybe it's an intentional value and not actual. Yes, Ms. Barbara. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. The church is going to, you absolutely better believe it. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. Think about the mindset of the younger people, especially younger parents. Go if you want a preview of that, just go into Walmart over there. And the kids are destroying the dresses and throwing them on the floor, and mom and dad don't say a word. That's what you're dealing with, because that's the reality of the culture that we live in. And so what I'm saying is, if you want younger people here, guess what? We may have to sacrifice. You may have to give up your seat where you always sit. Shock. So here's the deal. If we say this is what we want, then we need to come up and see, is this really what we want, or is it we just want to talk about it? Because we can talk about a lot of things, and they're all wonderful, but when it comes down to where the rubber meets the road, I'll give you an example. We're fixing to revamp the little church from top to bottom. It's new leadership, new everything. You know what I'm saying? It's going to cost some money. And when we get them munchkins here, guess what's going to happen? They're going to tear up some stuff. I'm just telling you, straight up. And it may be your grandkids that are tearing it up. All right? That's what comes along with saying, we want children here. Because children tear up stuff. Say amen. I can't get people who are 70 years old to leave the thermostats alone. What do you expect the kid's going to see when he sees the light come on? Man, mash that button. Right? So, yes, it is a sacrifice. And I go you one step further, and I'm getting ahead of myself. It is a sacrifice because it is change. It is to move away from what we consider to be normal. And you know, whether we realize it or not, and I got a slide on this, but I'm not going to it just yet. Whether you realize it or not, we're changing all the time. The only thing that's constant in the world is change. If you don't believe this, I'm tell you what. There used to be a day when somebody said, hey, my car needs service. I pitch out underneath that thing. Man, change your oil before you know what's going on. I can't even get under the car now. On a lift. You know, because you know what? I'm getting older. Because it ain't as easy to do as it once was. Right? So I'm changing, whether I like it or not. But now today, when you say change in a Baptist church, you better have an armor suit on. We've always done it that way. We've been here 118 years, yes, and it ain't never worked. You know what I'm saying? But we're going to keep doing it because that's the way we've always done it. Now think about that for a minute, right? That's what. Can you think of anything in your life that you've always done the same way? Always. Think back to when you was a kid. Can y'all remember that far back? I have trouble sometimes, right? Can you think of anything that you've always done the same? Always is a God word. He's the only one that can always. I give you one step further. He's the only one that can never and be consistent. I'm never going to do that again. Yep, you just keep talking all that big smack if you want to. You'll find yourself upside down before you know what's going on. Good. So here's the deal. Why do we do that when we say, these are our values? Well, you know what? If these are truly our values, if they're real and not just words on a paper, then it's going to require some change. We're going to have to do things differently. And I go you one step further. Here's really the kicker of it. It may change several times in the church here. Because here's the deal. You remember what I told you? The definition of crazy is what? Do the same thing and expect a different outcome. Is that not right? So if we try something and it don't work, why would we do it again next year? That make any sense? Light bulbs going on here, any at all, or I'm just getting that look like, I don't know, he's crazy. Because, well, he is crazy too. That's what Miss Carla said. So the idea is that, guess what? What we call valuable to us about our church, and you have the list of them, they're the ones you called out, okay? You determine whether they're real or whether they're just a good intention. Because you know what? We can intend to do a lot of things, but if we never act on them, guess what? They're really not values, okay? They're really not values. Now, let's look at something else here. That's not all we talked about. We talked about vision. Vision, according to Webster's, is a mental image of what the future will or could be like. I was reading Tony Evans today, and he said, vision always occurs twice. It occurs to the person first who has the vision, and then it occurs again when that vision becomes a reality. For it to be a real vision, it'll occur twice. Does that make any sense? Okay? See it in your mind. You've met these kind of people, okay? And Sam's one of them. You know what I'm saying? And Sonny's one of them. You start talking about building something, and in their mind, they see a picture of what it looks like. Okay? I'm only good for the post hole diggers, and then if it's been cleared so I don't chop a line into. So I can't see that. I mean, unless you draw it out, I don't understand. When you say, well, it's going to be this long and that long and this tall, I don't see it. But they do. All right? That's something that God has given them and gifted them with. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes it's just you've been around it so long, you know what I'm saying? In their mind, they've already built it. Well, that vision occurs once up here, and then when it becomes a reality. Okay? So vision occurs twice. All right? But that's not all we said, okay? We said there was a difference between a vision and a wish list. Now, you have your visions in front of you. Okay? It's on the back side of that paper. All right? Well, Miss Carol, saving up paper, wasn't she? Okay? All right? And we talked a little bit about vision, and we talked a little bit about a wish list. Okay? Now, when you see that vision, and I would encourage you to put your visions on there. What you see. Okay? When you see that vision on there, let me ask you this. Where would you put it? Okay, we want a larger enrollment. A larger enrollment. Is that an actual vision, or is that need to go into the wish list? Thank you, ma'am. And I guess what I really need to say is this. For some people, it really is a vision, okay? But would you say for the overwhelming majority, it is what? It's a wish. And the reason being, just like Ms. Angie said, we don't put any feet to it. We don't put any effort toward it. We just sit around and say, man, wouldn't it be nice to have 400 people in here? Yeah, it would, wouldn't it? Okay, what are you doing specifically? Then somebody will say, well, you know, I don't do good with people. I don't. You know what? We have a list of everybody who is absent from our Sunday school. Every Sunday, the directors get a list of people who are absent. Every Sunday, if you don't come to Sunday school, guess what? It's a wish for you. Because guess how the church grows? Through Sunday school. Whichever way, I heard a professor tell me this one time, whichever way the Sunday school goes, that's the way the church will go. Sunday school falls off, guess what will happen to regular attendance? It'll fall off, that's exactly right. When people aren't dedicated to Sunday school, guess what happens? They're not dedicated to anything else the church is doing. So if we say we want a larger church enrollment and we understand that Sunday school is vital to that, then let me ask you this. Are you in a Sunday school class? And are you an active member of that Sunday school class? Which means, you know, I show up, yeah, I get me a book, you know, I never read it, but I got one, and I show up about every third week. Or are you saying, hey, that's my Sunday school class? As a matter of fact, actually, that's the way, Brother Jimmy's not here tonight, that I refer to the fruit bearers. That's my Sunday school class. That's where I go to Sunday school. And when people aren't there, you know what? They need to be contacted. And I go you one step further. They don't just need a card. They don't just need a phone call. After the third time, somebody needs to go to their house. Somebody from that class needs to say, I know you're sick. We want to come over and want to pray with you. Do you know what that would do for our Sunday school? You talk about enrollment increasing. You talk about classes that grow into other classes because they've got so big they can't all get in one room. That's what happens. But to say I have a vision for it and to say, you know, so-and-so wasn't in Sunday school Sunday. Hope they're doing okay. That's a wish. Because you're not willing to put any effort toward it to make it anything different. Now, I'm not going to go through all of these because we don't have time to go through them tonight, but I want you to look at this list, and don't throw my list away. Put it in your Bible with all the rest of the gum wrappers and all that other stuff, because we're going to come back to this. Because I'm going to ask you, what is a wish and what is a vision? Because you remember what our scripture said, Proverbs 29. If there is no vision, what? People perish. And you know what? There are more. I read a statistic today in Canada, and I can't remember what it was. They're on average. Now let me back up. Let me go to England, okay? In England, the Church of England is closing and or selling 1,000 churches a year. 1,000 church buildings a year. They have a committee called the Church Closing Committee. That's all they... Ma'am? Nope. It's going secular. It turns into car dealerships and, you know what I'm saying, cafes and all that kind of stuff. And the Southern Baptist Convention is saying that in a year, 15,000 Southern Baptist churches will close. 15,000 will close. And they die like it for lack of interest. Yes, Brother Ernie. And I'll go you one step further. Think about this for just a minute. And this is purely from a business standpoint, okay? Do you know how many hundreds of thousands of dollars a church facility is worth? And they are sold for pennies on the dollar. Because, you know, hey, I'm not going to use this for this, man. I'm going to gut all this stuff out and make a nightclub out of it. Now stop and think about that for a minute. Why is that? What creates that? This is a thing. There's a program. It's a concept that comes out of Dallas Theological Seminary, and it is generational revitalization. Okay, generational revitalization. All right. And what it says is that there comes a time when the congregation is at a point. It's make or break. They either have to learn to change or they simply go away. Now, you've heard me tell you this, you know, with our nursery ministry, okay? Now, there ain't a person here that is unable to work in that nursery. Yet, we can't find people to go in there to save our life. Now, you say, well, man, we need some kids. Well, why aren't you working in the nursery? Well, if we just looked around here and all of us volunteered one Sunday, you wouldn't have to do it once a year. But yet we can get no one to work in the nursery. Miss Peggy is back there every time by herself or with somebody else. She has to be in there every service. That's because no one has a vision for it. But the problem is, if we ignore them, guess what will happen? They'll go away. Absolutely. They will go away. So the deal is this. Are we genuine in what we say? Or are we just wish that would happen? Because it ain't going to happen until somebody puts feet to their faith. Till somebody says, these kids are important enough for an hour or 2 hours of my time on Sunday. They're important enough that somebody needs to be in there with them. And I'll tell you what, if somebody else will preach, I'll stay in there with them. Because Rocco's here usually on Sundays. And I'll just smooch her like nobody's business. I'll change no diapers, but I'll smooch her all over. But yet we say that they're important. So is this beginning to make any sense at all? And don't think for a minute that we've been here 118 years, we're going to be here 118 more. There ain't no guarantee on that. You see what I'm saying? Because as the people lose the vision for the church, to reach the community. Now, let me ask you this. Is this community the same community it was 50 years ago? Is it the same community it was 20 years ago? Or has it changed?
Not even 10 years.
Not even 5 years. How about that? It's not the same place. Why do we think we can continue on in the same path we were and everything's going to be hunky-dory? When the community is changing around us, who are we supposed to be reaching? The community. Does that make any sense? So, yeah, there are some things that, you know what I'm saying, are going to have to change, all right? And I want to keep going back to that. But to me, the difference between a wish list and a vision, they're separated by action. They're separated by the say. Somebody coming up with a plan to say, this is what we're going to do. Now, I'll be the first one to tell you, I'm not hip on programs, okay? I don't think you ought to have a program just for the sake of having a program. Matter of fact, I talked to the children's ministry team Sunday and said, look, I don't want to have activities just for the sake of having activities. I want them to be something that benefits our children in them learning about Jesus. Isn't that what we're supposed to be here for? Okay. Got a mess around here, killed the whole afternoon. All right. Now, next thing I want to talk about this is goals. Okay. Now, you've got a blank piece of paper on the back side of your wish list. Or it's not blank. It's got goals at the heading. Does everybody see that? Okay. Everybody got one of those? Okay. Take them out. Anybody need a pen? All right. Okay. And I separated these into two. Okay. Now, goal, according to Webster, is the object of a person's ambition or effort, an aim or desired results. Okay. Now, here's the first thing I want you to think about. Don't raise your hand because we're recording all this, okay? What ministries, I want you to list them, what ministries do you participate in at Bethesda Baptist Church? Write them down. Enough time, you don't need another one. I like Jeopardy. I'm just not smart enough to play it. How long is your list? Don't say. Wayne, get Sonny an escort. Gail out. How long is your list? Let me ask you this. Is your list blank? And if it's blank, why is it blank? Well, preacher, I'm not a teacher, and I don't do this, and I don't do that, and I don't work in the media, and I don't know. You know what every one of us could put right there under that first heading under church goals? Work in the nursery. Nod your head. Every one of us could take a day in the nursery. Would y'all agree with that? Am I right or wrong? Okay. What about Sunday school? Is Sunday school on your list of ministries? That's a ministry. You know what I'm saying? Do you participate in Sunday school or you just... They do have to have a background check before they work with children. Anytime you work with children here, you have to have a background check.
Is the nursery for men and women or just...
Absolutely. Absolutely. Husband and wife teams. Pat, looking better and better and better for you, brother. yeah, it could be teams. I'm sorry. A choir is a ministry, absolutely. Brother David, is a choir the ministry? It's a ministry, ain't it? Okay. Okay, so now you've wrote down whatever it is you participate in, all right? Hopefully you got three or four things on there, all right? And not seven or eight. But anyway, so you have those down there, okay? Now what I want you to do is I want you to go beside whatever it is you wrote down, and I want to ask you this. What is your goal for that ministry? What is your goal for that ministry? Don't tell nobody else. Don't let them look on your paper. Maria Pat's cheating. Right next to goal, right there, I want you to put, what is your goal for whatever ministry it is that you participate in?
My vision is different from
hers. And it might be. Well, wait a minute, though. But the vision, that's not what we're talking about now. Vision, we're talking about what is the goal. You're saying, I participate in this ministry, and I'm asking you, what is your goal for that ministry? Now, it would be horrible if Miss Carla said, I'm our WMU director, and I have no goal for my ministry. I don't want it to get better. I don't want us to minister to more people. I don't want us to raise more money. I'm in Sunday school. You know what my goal for my Sunday school class? I don't have one. And you want to know why Sunday school is in trouble? Because you ain't got no goal. You know what somebody told me about goals? If you ain't got no goal, don't worry. You'll hit it every time. Think about that for a minute now. You ain't got no goal. Your goal is to do nothing. And unfortunately, you know those churches that are being sold? That's because they're full of people who don't want to do nothing. All right? I know it's the preacher's job. That's what we pay him for. That's what the deacons are supposed to do. See, it's always somebody else except who? Okay? All right, you get them? Nobody got them. Okay. Because you need to write them down. You need to think about this coming week now because we're going to share these next Wednesday. All right. Oh, you'll have a whole week to make up some really neat stuff. Huh? All right. Here's the next question. What are your goals for the church in general? What are your goals for the church? Not necessarily a ministry you're participating in, but for Bethesda Baptist Church, what are your goals? No, you can't say them out loud. Running the preacher off is not supposed to be a good goal. What is your goal for the church in general? Now, you remember what I told you about a vision? Remember I told you the scary part is that we had about 60 people and we only had what? About 13, 14 statements, which means that what? There was about 40 or 50 people here who had no vision for the church. The same thing is true with the goals. If you have no goal for Bethesda Baptist Church, do not worry. We will eventually come down to your expectations. It's just a matter of time. It ain't if, it's when. Yes, Ms. Lee.
I think this should be done on Sunday morning when they got a lot of people.
Well,
Sunday night and we don't have a handful of people.
Well, but here's the deal, okay? You know the old saying is, the people who come on Sunday mornings, and you look at our numbers, okay? These are the people that come to church how many times a week?
Once.
Most of them don't even participate in Sunday school, okay? So these people are wonderful, and we're going to minister to them all we can. Are they disciples? Chances are, usually not. They're going to get whatever they're going to get on Sunday morning, and they're done. Okay? So the saying is that, you know what? You have a whole bunch of people on Sunday morning. You have kind of the faithful on Sunday night. The people you can really depend on show up on Wednesdays. Okay, and I agree with you. I think you're absolutely right. I think it's an absolute wonderful goal. How do we get there? See, that's the question, see, because while it's wonderful to think about that, and I agree with you, I'll be quite honest with you. I'd love for the 30-something crowd to populate this place like nobody's business. All right, so what do we do then to make that happen? See, it's real easy when you say it fast. It's different when you start trying to put things in place that make that possible. Yes, Ms. Barbara. Skinny jeans, yeah. You want me to get some skinny jeans, Ms. Barbara?
No.
She said, no, please, please. Well, and that won't always hold them here.
No.
I mean, we have a ton of visitors, folks. Man, I call them and I say, hey, look, you know, can we come over and visit with you? Most time they say no. But, I call them and say, hey, are y'all, is everything okay? You know, we really did like having y'all there. And, you know, for the overwhelming majority, the majority of them tell us, yeah, it's a nice church. People love one another. All those things you listed is right. They said, man, that's great. But here's the deal, right? Whatever we have to do can coexist with whatever we're doing now. It doesn't have to be one or the other. Matter of fact, I've talked to some preachers that have very large churches, 500 plus, right? That have split to this two service thing where it's a contemporary service in the morning and then or in the afternoon and a traditional, and they're split. You know what you do when you do that? You wind up with two churches, is exactly what you wind up with. So they have to blend. There has to come to a point where, you know, I'm saying, no, I don't need smoke. But in the same token, you know, don't pull out the AED. You know what that is? That's the thing to shock your heart. When the music director walks up with a guitar on him. My gosh, I can't believe it. It's the devil. You understand what I'm saying? You have to come to a point where you have to blend it. And there is a point where they can coexist. You know what I'm saying? Now, I'll be honest with you. When I talk about change, I'll be the first one to tell you I'm not willing to compromise my standards or my values as it relates to the Word of God. I will not compromise that for anybody. Amen. To draw any group, any demographic. But you have to understand what's going on here, okay? If you think about this for just a minute, all right? Can y'all remember a time when church was an hour long? I mean, the preacher preached for an hour. Can anybody here remember that? I can. I can remember a strong 45-minute sermon was nothing. Okay? All right, today what do? If we do 30 minutes, we're lucky. Why? People hate preaching. No. Just think about it. Right? When those people were young, how long was a radio program? It's usually an hour. It was usually an hour. Okay? Now, it had commercials intermixed in it and all that kind of stuff. All right, today, TV programs are what? They're 30 minutes, and it ain't a full 30 minutes. Okay? You see what's happening to people's attentions? Okay? I've talked to people who are standing there at a rec site with somebody who is dead that they claim to be their best friend, and they never looked up from their telephone. Never looked up from their telephone. So what does that tell you? Culture is changing. Is that not right? Does that mean that these people are unreachable? That absolutely does not. The power of the gospel can reach anybody. Okay? But it does mean this, what? Maybe the way we deliver it might need to change. Or at least, at the very least, be tweaked. Yes, ma'am. I had a man tell me he goes to a very large church. Matter of fact, I saw him at Doctor's Hospital when I was down to visit Ms. Warren. And he goes to a church that has some activities for his teenage son. Okay. Matter of fact, they have a whole camp for it every year. That's how big it is. So I asked him, I said, how's things going out at the church? And if I called the name, you'd know who I'm talking about. And they talked, yada, yada, yada. He said, man, it's going great. I said, kids are loving this and loving that. I said, that's wonderful. So I said, how's the preaching going out there? He said, I really do believe that I would enjoy it if I could understand a thing this guy is saying. So this guy's preaching over his head, and the only reason he's going there is not to be edified, but to make sure that his kids got something to do. Now, does that tell you how important that is? Because my thing to him is, you're risking your eternity on whether or not your kid can play kickball or whatever. See what I'm saying? This is a true statement. But here's the deal. Now think about this for a minute, okay? And we got to close. We're way over. I'm going to get shot, okay? But think about this for just a second, okay? What would you be willing to do different than we do now if that would help attract younger people? Well, I'll give you one. You willing to work in a nursery? Oh, you willing to work in the junior church? Because I told you, we're fixing to revamp that thing from top to bottom. We're fixing to start putting ministry team people in there to work with the folks that work in junior church. You're going to get a chance to teach. Maybe even your own grandkids. I ain't doing that, preacher. Okay, well, how important was it? You see where I'm coming from? You know what I'm saying? I don't do that Sunday school thing, but it's doing early in the morning. Well, then how important is it to you? Think about it. I mean, I'm just saying, you know. That's my wife tells me. It drives me crazy. I'm just saying. I want you to think about spiritually or personal goals, okay? Romans, I want you to write this verse down. Romans 8 and 29 says, "For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren." Write that down. Because if you have no goal spiritually, that should be your goal. To be conformed to the image of his son. And guess what you find out when you read that next verse? It happens little by little by little. You don't wake up one morning and say, "Boy, I'm religious." Well, yeah, yes you do. That's a problem in itself. "Man, I just walk with God." Yeah, whole 30 minutes. What are your personal goals spiritually for you, for your family? If you have children, grandchildren, whatever, that are in your home, what is your goal for them? They don't come to church. They don't want to come to church. Then you know what your goal is? Let them perish. That's your goal? They don't like to come. It's hard to get up in the morning. Is anybody here it's easy to get up in the morning other than Sam that's here at 5 o'clock? Gail, I don't want to hear that. Gail, doggone it. That's only because you can't sleep. If you could, you would. Oh, well, I guess if you go to bed with the chicken. I used to kid my wife about that, about 8:30. But man, 5 o'clock in the morning, she is slamming every door in that house. But the dogs can't even sleep. I mean, you know. So. But anyway, we're going to stop right here. We're going to pick up next week. Don't throw your sheet away. All right? Because I expect it to be filled out next week. All right? Yes, you can, Brother Ernie.
It's painful what we've become for the Savior that we love.
Well, and we're going to deal with that next week. We're actually going to deal with change next week, okay? So encourage you to come back. We're going to finish these goals up too, okay? Brother Ernie, if you don't mind, would you close our services and pray for our church?